Hey, this is Danny Denko here, Senior Cultivation Editor for High Times Magazine. We're here in Richmond, California at our fourth annual High Times Medical Cannabis Cup here in the Bay Area. We've done two in San Francisco and two out here in Richmond. We really love it. This is a wonderful venue. I think it might be our favorite venue that we've done this event at. We're at the Craneway Pavilion. Wonderful views of the Bay. We've got a Ferris wheel here this year. We've got two medicating areas. Great, wonderful seminars, Normal Women's Alliance, edibles, concentrates, cultivation, activism. We're just really excited to continue to spread the good word here in the Bay Area about cannabis, all the wonderful things that can be done with this great plant. So we're showing the world that we can gather peacefully, we can celebrate the plant, and we can organize, and we can continue the fight, because the fight goes on to free marijuana for all responsible adult use. We want to inform as many people as to what's going on and get them involved on a local level. I mean, really what would be great is a change on a federal level, and that's what we're really hoping for in the near future if we can get it. It's a tough road, but we're trying very hard to achieve that.
Also, could you just elaborate a little bit on, are you aware about the government spending like $300 million to fight? And that tax dollars coming from the cannabis industry?
Absolutely, and I think it's even closer to maybe $500 million, which is $500 million that a Democratic administration is spending with the Justice Department to crack down on perfectly legal dispensaries here in California, following state laws and as the will of the people. I mean, this was decided by vote. So for politicians and for the government, for the Department of Justice, and even for Mr. Obama to stand in the way of the people's vote and what they want, and clearly the patients of California, the people of California have spoken. They want access to cannabis. And so to blockade that is shameful of the Department of Justice, it's shameful of the administration, and they really need to reevaluate the situation and figure out where that money is better spent, because as far as I can tell, they're laying off school teachers left and right, and they're laying off cops and firemen and all kinds of municipal people, and what they need to be doing is using our taxpayer money in order to help us, not to prosecute us, and not to just continue to harass this community, because clearly the public is on our side, and that's what we want to convey to the powers that be. They've been screaming this like Mexican cartel growing in the national parks thing for a long time. There's really very little evidence of that, and especially in this day and age where it's so difficult to get away with that kind of thing. I feel like the closer we get to legal, the less that opportunities like that exist for a so-called cartel or for some kind of a criminal organization to get involved in this world, because as long as we self-regulate and we have a regulated industry, you can't be a cowboy and you can't pull stuff like that off acres and acres and acres of government land that you're growing on. I'm sorry, that would be frowned upon, but if you have a permit and a license to grow in a certain facility, you should be allowed to do it without harassment, and that's right. Where we're getting to now. And you notice that in places like Denver, in places like LA and San Francisco, the prices are going down. So the more access people have to production, to legal, quasi-legal production of this plant, the more we're producing and the cheaper every ounce becomes. And that's a great thing. And I think that's nothing anyone should be afraid of. We should not be paying these prohibition inflated prices that are based on how much risk that the grower takes. It really doesn't cost that much to grow marijuana. So it shouldn't cost that much to buy it either. So that's where we're at. I mean, the key to getting the most out of every plant is to put the most into every plant. Grow big, you know, veg the plant for a longer period of time, use larger containers so that the roots have room to spread out and to grow and to become a massive root system, because you can't have a massive ganja plant without a massive root system to support it. So the bigger your container, and I'm talking about 5 gallon container minimum, you know, I'm talking about 15, 20, 35 gallon containers and vegging the plants for over a month at a time so that you get a big bush before you've even started to flower. And then once you begin the flowering process, you already have branches upon which you can build large colas, and that's the way you get the most out of every plant. And in this era where they're giving us limits as to how many plants we can grow, it's our obligation to get the most out of every plant, because hey, that's our limit. So let's push it as each plant as big as we can get it. And if you're growing outdoors, that means you start the plants indoors and get them to a certain height before you even put them outside. And then they get a chance to grow all summer long and get bigger, and then by the time they're flowering in the fall, they're taller than you are. Well, as far as harvesting, you can't do it without some kind of a microscope or a loupe or some way to look really closely at the glandular trichome. And the glandular trichome is the gland head that actually contains the THC. It looks like a tiny little mushroom, and it glistens. It's that crystal that people see when they look at a bud. But if you look at it close enough, it's got a stalk and a head. Yeah, and the head starts off clear. You can see right through it. Then it becomes slightly cloudy, and then it starts to turn amber. And you want to catch it when it's cloudy, when the majority of the trichomes are cloudy but not amber. Some will be amber, some will be clear, but majority of them will be cloudy in the middle. That's a good time to harvest. Now, if you want something that's more lethargic, something that is more of a couch-locky, stony kind of thing, you let it go a little longer, a little more amber. But you don't want to harvest when all those gland heads are clear, because you're taking the plant down too early. And I find a lot of people are harvesting too soon. They're not waiting the
impatient.
Extra two. They're impatient. They're not waiting that extra 2 weeks. And that doesn't give them the time to flush the plants either, because that's important. You need to use plain water, pH-balanced water, for at least 2 weeks at the end of your grow, so that you can leach out some of the excess nutrients and salts and metals and things that you've added. In order to get a cleaner burning product. And that's the only way you're gonna win a cannabis cup. You have to have something that burns properly to a clean white ash that just falls off the joint, you know? And it's gotta taste good at the end of the joint, just like it tastes at the beginning of the joint. You don't get that without a proper flush and a proper cure when you harvest.
Because you're going to some of the dispensaries, and some of the bud tenders don't even know about trichome count.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So what I've noticed, that when you smoke and you get that nice, milky white smoke, you know it's high enriched in THC.
Absolutely. And if it's a dark smoke, if it burns like a piece of charcoal, then you know it's overfed and it's got too much nutrient in the bud and wasn't leached out through the flushing process. And that's really important. Curing does that as well, to a certain extent. You have to cure the bud to get the last excess moisture out, you know, so that it's perfectly cured bud. You harvest from the harvest to when the buds are dry. You're hanging them dry at that point. They should be dry within, you know, 7 to 10, maybe even 14 days, when they're dry enough to cut off the hanging buds and put into your jars to start the curing process. So let's say 2 weeks from harvest or so, you know, a week to 2 weeks is when you can, you know, when you snap the stem, you know, when you bend the stem and it breaks instead of bending, then you're ready to put it into a jar. And some of the moisture from the middle is going to work its way out. So when you put it in the jar, you're going to think it's bone dry. And then that moisture is going to work itself out within an hour or two in a sealed jar. The bud will feel moist again. That's the inner moisture working its way out to the outside of the bud. And you do that over a period of time, over and over. You open the jar, you let the moist air out, dry air is replacing it, and it's sucking the moisture out of the middle of the bud through the outside of the bud. And then when you get it to a perfect balance where it's no longer moistening and drying and moistening and drying, then you have cured the bud. And you can keep it in that state for a long period of time, as long as you store it in a sealed jar in a cool, dark place. So that's what we recommend. No fridge, no freezer, just a nice cupboard where it's dark and cool. Yeah, I mean, I always recommend organic techniques to deal with all of that, because any kind of chemical technique that you use is something you're going to be consuming later on. So spraying with bug sprays and stuff, that's going to hurt you later, or hurt whoever's going to be smoking. So I recommend integrated pest management. That means using neem oil. That means using beneficial bugs, because there's, for every vegetarian bug that's eating our plant, there's a carnivorous bug that you can sick on, you know, you can send on that plant to attack the vegetarian one that's hurting your plant. And the carnivorous bug is just gonna destroy all the vegetarians and then bounce.
Bugs are good?
Ladybugs are good, yeah. I mean, They're not going to destroy a whole population. You need to use ladybugs in conjunction with other things like
the neem oil and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, but they will help in reducing a pest population mm-hmm. to a level where it's manageable and you can attack it from various different ways. Mold and mildew is a serious issue, especially out here out west. Powdery mildew seems to be a big problem. There's various ways of dealing with that. Sulfur burners that you can use in an indoor situation. Outdoors, you're kind of at the mercy of the outdoor
the elements,
but yeah, there's various sprays too, fungicidal sprays that aren't all too harmful or anything. So there's ways to deal with funguses as well. The important thing also is for people when they're dealing with pests is to look on the underside of the leaves, because a lot of times they're on the underside
of
the
leaves.
And when you're treating them, treat the underside of the leaves, the top of the leaves, and the top of the soil, because they're in that top couple of inches of soil. That's a good breeding place for them. They live in there, especially if it's moist a lot. Fungus gnats will be an issue, and the larvae eat the roots and stuff, so it's a problem. So
what about LED lights now in the industry?
LED lights are getting better and better, cheaper and cheaper. You know, we're keeping our eye on that. You can grow great bud with LED lights. Don't let anybody convince you can't do it. It's just the cost of the LEDs is still pretty high,
right?
And the technology is such that you need to find the right LED light,
right,
if you really want to grow dense bud. So
what's the recommendation for a really good one?
I mean, the Stealth Grow light is one of the best I've seen that's commercially available. It's called Stealth Grow LED. That's a great one. I've seen great results with my own eyes of people growing lots of bud with those. The reduction in heat and the reduction in electrical cost is very significant. So for the future, we could definitely see LED lights flourishing, especially in an indoor grow type situation. Ideally, as marijuana becomes more and more legal, we won't be relying so much on these indoor lights, and I hope we'll rely more on the sun.
Natural light.
And turn back to the sun and have a greenhouse with supplemental lighting, so that, hey, if the sun's not giving us enough light on a certain day, we've got our lights, we can turn them on and off, but we need to use as much of this natural resource as that we have to grow plants with. That's a perfect grow light in the sky. So I think, and it also reduces the cost of the product, because you're not spending so much in electricity.
Right.
And you can still control the environment the way an indoor garden is, with a greenhouse, with supplemental lighting, air conditioning, and all those things that you can add and subtract.
It's a win-win situation.
Yeah, I think so. It's a much greener way of growing. Indoor growing is not a particularly eco-friendly way to do this thing.
Right. A lot of things, you got a lot of parameters to it and stuff like that.
Keep it green. All right, this is Danny Danko, Senior Cultivation Editor of High Times Magazine, and you're watching VU Film Productions.
That's tight.